of the house of Israel out of the north country, and from all countries whither I had driven them, and they shall dwell in their own land. No more will they say that the Exodus or the deliverance from Egypt is our identifying trademark. But they will say the Lord was brought and led the seed of the house of Israel from all the places they've been driven. And I want to preach to you for a few minutes tonight on this subject. When deliverance from Egypt is no longer your greatest testimony.
Hallelujah.
When deliverance from Egypt is no longer your greatest testimony. Pray with me right now. Dear Jesus, I love you tonight. I thank you for this great group of people that have come to worship together. I praise you for your spirit. Praise you for the singers and the songs and the musicians and the great abilities and talents that are displayed in this service. I pray, God, that this word will minister to us, that there be a door open. God, you know we've been knocking on this door for several weeks now. And I pray, God, that the door will open and enlightenment will set in, and we will realize the role that we have in the kingdom of God has been designed and purposed since the beginning of time. I pray your blessings and your anointing upon every ear to hear, every heart to understand, every mind to comprehend, and anoint me, Lord, to deliver this anointed word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. The Exodus from Egypt, of which the second book of the Bible is titled, has always been Israel's defining moment. It was the first evidence that many of them had seen of the miraculous hand of God bringing deliverance to his people. It began, it actually began in a time of fleshly disappointment. When Abraham and Lot divided their people, Brother Pete, and Lot, in his youthful exuberance and looking through the eyes of the flesh, he chose the well-watered plains of Jordan.
Yeah.
And when Abraham looked at what he had left, Brother Robbie, it wasn't much to the carnal eye. And you can't help but realize and experience the disappointment that Abraham felt when it looked like he got the short end of the straw.
Amen.
But the Lord took him to a high place.
Oh, yes.
And he said, I want you to look to the north, the south, the east, and the west. And as far as you can see, I give it to you.
Yes.
I said, I give it to you.
Yes.
No matter what Lot just said, doesn't matter what's going on in Sodom and Gomorrah, doesn't matter what you see through your carnal eyesight,
yeah.
I give it to you. Yeah. He promised him, he said, your children will be as the stars in the heaven. In number, and as the sand of the sea in number. And through many miraculous means, the children of Israel became a people. And as I said a few services ago, Egypt was the incubator in which that they were brought to life.
Yeah.
They became a people in Egypt, Brother Pete, but Egypt was never their home.
Yeah.
They were in Egypt, and just to put it in perspective, the children of Israel, from the time they left Goshen as a family of 70 some odd, until the time that they came out in the Exodus, they were in Egypt longer than the United States of America has even been a country. And there's nobody in this room right now that will not, with pride in their heart and if they have any good sense, that will not readily confess, I have Scotch, Dutch, Irish, I'm just truthfully, no offense to any of my family members, but we're a little bit of a mutt. We got all different kinds of backgrounds, Indian, and you just name it, we got it. But I will swear Please stay with me tonight. They never became Egyptians. After 430 some odd years, they became under heavy oppression. They came to live a life that they dreaded getting up in the morning. They lived a life that the Egyptians made it more and more and more and more difficult on them to even survive. They became slaves for Egyptians' taskmasters. And at Egypt's time of greatest prosperity, all the work was done by the children of Israel. But when that cry came up to the Lord, Brother McKinney, the Lord God Almighty spoke to Moses out of a burning bush and said, go get my people and tell them I am has sent you. So with the benefit of 9 plagues, culminating with a visitation of the death angel on the last one, and only those who had put the blood on their doorposts as God had commanded, both sides and over the top, only the ones with blood on the doorposts were passed over. Hence the institution of the greatest religious festival, the Passover, was begun.
Amen.
Deuteronomy 6 and 4, which is part of the Shema, which it would do you well to study it out, when it declares, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. They were also to tell their children, their grandchildren, their great-grandchildren, so on and so forth, reciting daily, and let them know that when their offspring ask, why do we do this? They are told that the reason for their declaration was due to the mighty hand of God that brought them out of Egyptian bondage.
Yes,
Stephen, the very first Christian martyr, if you read his story in Acts chapter number 7, I believe it is, very strongly as he preached to his very executioners, strongly declared the story of the Exodus in his speech just before his death by stoning. And he declared it as a foundational truth that was in accord with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Throughout the New Testament, we're given a glimpse into the allegorical truth of the message of salvation being a type of a personal exodus. No one should read anything into this message that says that there will come a day when we should forget about our deliverance from Egypt. Because Egypt is a type of the world. Words cannot really describe the power of salvation experience like the Bible says. God help us as the children of the living God to not look disparagingly or not look critically upon people of other beliefs that claim to have been saved by some experience they had. But let us look upon them with compassion because they do not realize how beautiful it is to be filled with the Spirit of God. When we repent of our sins, when we are baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, the only saving name is that of Jesus Christ. We are filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, evidenced by speaking in other tongues. I feel like I need to tell you tonight, tongues is not the Holy Ghost. Don't pray for tongues. Don't pray to speak in tongues. Praise God for the Holy Ghost, and when He fills you up, you will speak with other tongues. It's the evidence. It is a supernatural manifestation of the Almighty God in us. And through the power of the Holy Ghost, we are delivered from the clutches and the penalties of sin.
Yes, right.
No, I'm not suggesting we forget. I'm preaching to us that by the help of the Lord, there's still mountains to climb, rivers to swim, loved ones and friends to see saved. The work of God in us, through us, and by us will never be done.
Right.
One of the most common things we say, I've heard it said many times at the funeral home, and Brother McKinney, sometimes well-meaning people who feel like at a time of a loss that there just needs to be something said are better off keeping their mouth shut. Brother Billy, I've heard some terrible damage done by well-meaning people. They'll say it gets better. They'll say, I know what you feel like. Please don't ever do that. Because you don't know what it feels like. and it doesn't get better. But we'd like to say, in the face of sorrow or a tragedy or any other myriad of trials we go through, maybe a separation or in a marital situation or in a father-son or mother-daughter or any of the other relationships, all the myriad of trials we go through, we like to think, believe, and hold on to the ideology that time heals all things. If we could just hold on a little while longer, everything's going to be better. Oh. Right?
Yeah.
Has anybody ever, can you relate to that? Going through a struggle, going through a trial, and if I can just hold on a little bit, things are going to get better. It won't hurt so bad. The distance between me and that trial will make things all better.
Yeah.
But I'm going to submit to you tonight that there are also things that time kills.
Yes.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, there are monumental events such as an unforeseen death or a really exciting vacation experience or maybe a boy or a girl met in a summer romance that at that particular moment, please somebody hear me right now, at that particular moment, we will build memorials, we will make promises, and we'll make plans that with the passing of time, they fade into obscurity because they were emotionally based. The baptism of the Holy Ghost, while being the furthest thing from simply an emotional experience, and I'm afraid that sometimes we, please don't misunderstand me, Brother McKinney, I'm always going to talk about how great it is to be in the presence of the Lord. I'm going to always talk about how it feels to talk in tongues and to pray through to the Holy Ghost and to have the Lord put His hand around your shoulders and just, like Sister Maria said, maybe in a quiet time, a private time, a time of despair, to feel the encouraging power of the Holy Ghost. I'm always going to talk about how beautiful it is to be in His presence, and I feel it in this place right now. How wonderful and comforting it is to have the arms of God Almighty wrapped around you and a feeling wiping away your tears and a feeling lifting your head up a little bit out of your trial and out of the quagmire that you might have found yourself in. I'm never going to stop talking about how good it feels to be with Jesus. But we can become hooked on the emotional high we experience initially. And when life gets in our way, we find ourselves failing to stay on fire for God as we once were. Our worship is not as dynamic as it once was. We aren't up out of our pew as quick as we once were. We sometimes coast through trying to just keep on going through the motions, as it were. We find ourselves, because of a lack of an emotional, exuberant high, find ourselves growing cold in the Lord. We've got to understand it wasn't a feeling that drew us to the Lord necessarily, but it was the knowledge that we were lost, the knowledge that we needed what He was offering. And it's not about feeling, it's about receiving the Spirit of God. And thankful, the Spirit of God comforts us, gives us peace. But the key to ensuring, and you say, well, I think you might be a little nuts. No, I'm going to keep my eyes shut. I don't know why I've been preaching with my eyes shut the last few months, every service. But there are some of you in this room right now that I've been calling your name out in prayer. Because the devil desires to have you. Because I've seen the exuberance diminishing. I've seen the excitement diminishing. I've seen that on fire burning diminishing. And it scares me, Brother McKinney. Because I was at a wedding last night. Person after person after person after person shook my hand, hugged my neck. Brother Pete that I used to go to church with right here.
That's right.
And I stood over there where Brother Johnny's sitting tonight and I prayed again. Lord, I don't want to lose anybody. Not a soul. Not willing to lose one soul. Whether the most productive or the one that just comes We're failing to listen to that still small voice.
Yeah.
But again, I'll refer to Sister Maria's testimony. That the comfort, the strength from that still small voice far surpasses any shouting experience I've ever had.
Amen. Amen. That's true.
Brother Rice, hearing the directing voice of God.
Yes.
Other than receiving the Holy Ghost. I'm gonna say this. Hearing that directed voice of God, Brother Pete, and knowing that you are walking in the perfect will of God. I want you to hear me right now. And this is what I said about you thinking I'm sacrilegious. It is better than when you first received the Holy Ghost. I know we're not supposed to preach that because we're, but God have mercy. If receiving the Holy Ghost is as good as it gets, what do we have to look forward to?
That's right.
I'm not being a heretic and a heathen, Brother Robbie, but there's something more for each of us in the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Yes. Amen.
That's true.
I love Brother Russ. I'm consumed with it. I've got stacks of books I haven't even read yet on my desk. I am consumed with saying the right word, getting the right spirit moving until I see people. I'm calling some of your names out. I know what God wants to do for you. But until you will embrace it and open up that door to fulfillment.
Yeah.
I want to tell you, your deliverance from the world is never supposed to be your greatest testimony.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
The key to ensuring that we never fall out of love with Him. Only learn to respond when everything's juking and jiving. It's to realize that being brought out of Egypt was never our destination. It was never our pinnacle. In fact, it's only the beginning. Deliverance from sin in the world and the influence of the world must certainly be our focus. But there will be a letdown unless we find our purpose in the kingdom and begin to walk in it. For Israel, their purpose was a country, a land to call their own. The very land that Abraham looked at off the top of that barren, dry desert hill so many years before.
Hallelujah.
I have been delivered. You have been delivered. We have seen people filled with the Holy Ghost. Sister Rita, I talked about you at General Conference. I told Brother Chinwood, I said, I had somebody get the Holy Ghost in the baptistry. And Brother Chinwood said, boy, it's been a long time since I've seen that. But it's exciting, Brother Pete. The Lord's doing great things. Our faith should be high. The power of the Holy Ghost is moving. But we weren't delivered just to brag people out of service, but you've been delivered for a purpose. We are a vessel that has been created by the potter to fulfill his desire and to fulfill his purpose. We are soldiers fighting on the side of the Lord, desiring to not let loose anybody. But not only circle the wagons, but to venture out into the arena of the enemy, fully armed and fully clothed with the whole armor of God.
Amen.
Fighting beside, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. I'm a sailor, sailing on a mission of salvation to a drowning world. I'm a teacher, sent to bring the message of hope to the world. I'm a healer, sent to see the sick healed through fasting and prayer and the laying on of hands, according to Mark chapter number 16. The only reason that you're to walk out of my office tonight, Brother McKinney, I hope you realize I'm not being ugly, but this is so needful. As I walk out of my office tonight, I saw people, Brother Billy, I saw people just like the children of Israel who for 40 plus years wandered in the wilderness against the will of God. It was never the will of God that they be in the wilderness. It was never the will of God that they fall short of the promised land. Never. But I saw people, please, please, don't misunderstand me, don't begrudge me, but I saw people in the spirit as they come off of that initial buzz. Does that make sense? And then so you got the Holy Ghost. First thing that's going to happen when life hits you, the first thing that's going to happen is the devil's going to say, you didn't have nothing in the first place. He got so told of all some of the bullshit. Devil's going to tell you you didn't have nothing in the first place. And if you don't get a hold of what I'm preaching tonight, you won't believe it. Well, McKinney, we were brought out of Egypt because God had a plan for us.
Amen.
Brought out of Egypt because we are the people of God. The Lord, it's not the will of God. Please, you know I love church. You know I love responding to church. Please don't misunderstand me. We weren't brought into the kingdom of God so we could show up on Sundays and Wednesdays and get our fix. The purpose of church service, the purpose of Sundays and Wednesdays is to get refueled to go out there and do battle. To get more strength to go out and do the will of God. The children of Israel wandered in the wilderness because they never realized that the power displayed in the Exodus wasn't just to get them out of Egypt, but it was to carry them all the way to the promised land. Approximately just a short time, maybe even 2 years, maybe less, after leaving Egypt, the children of Israel found themselves on the edge of the promised land. 12 spies were sent to check out the land. Cody, they were right there, bud. They were right there. Yeah. They were so close that Moses was able to get on the mountain and see it from the same area. Right. Brother Billy, they sent out 12 spies. Said, check it out. See if it's as good as God. See if it's as good as He promised.
Yeah.
Huh? And when they came back, Brother Pete, it was every bit as good as He promised. Amen. Nobody ever disputed the fact that it was what God said it was. Nobody ever disputed that it was as good as He said it was. But they said, we can't do it. Can't do it. Oh, it's great. Look at the fruit of it. It's great. It's wonderful. It's beautiful. Look at the fruit, and it flows with milk and honey. Just like He said. Everything He said is true. But there's giants, and they've got walled cities. Sorry. It was a good idea, Lord. I appreciate it. But I believe I'm just going to wait on the Sunday night buzz again. I believe I'm just going to wait on Brother G.L. to be up there and crank me up again. Let me tell you something, I ain't nobody's dancing dummy. I ain't nobody's little monkey that you crank up the box and I dance till the music was playing. But we've got to get a hold of something for each and every one of us that God has for us. There was a reason He brought you out of the hell you were living in. There's a reason why they shook you when you realized that you stuck a pipe in your mouth or you stuck a needle in your arm. Why He drug you out of that, and it wasn't just to get you away from that, but it was to take you where He wants you. Yes, 12 spies were sent to check out the land. They came back with a glowing report with two caveats. Abundant land, luscious fruit, full of milk and honey, but they're giants. And they're walled cities and we can't go. There were two men that felt that they were well able to go up and possess it. And He said, let's go up at once. and possess it. But Brother Rice, they threatened to stone him. How ignorant that they wanted to kill the voice of faith. So Joshua and Caleb were destined to roam in the wilderness, Brother McKinney, for over 40 years because of the unbelief of the majority. Joshua became a successor to Moses as the leader of the people of God. And while Caleb was in the promised land, he fell in love with a mountain. He fell in love with a part of the promised land that the Lord told him, because you have wholly followed me, the places where your foot touched are yours. So due to unbelief, after experiencing the greatness of what they were created for,
right,
they had to walk away from it. After all the unbelievers died, you come to the music that y'all have to sing again. After all the unbelievers died, those that remained were then about to go into the promised land. Joshua chapter 14, verse number 10, verse number 11, verse number 12. This is Caleb talking to Joshua. He tell you how important and how passionate you can be about your purpose. Caleb said, "And now, behold, the Lord hath kept me alive, as he said," listen to me, "these 40 and 5 years.
Hallelujah.
Is there anybody here 45? Longer than I've been alive. I was born March 22nd, 1973. So about from now back to what? 68? 69? How much has happened in those 45 years? For the people who fought a war, Vietnam, lost 55,000 of our boys over there, you know, never came home. We've seen the hippie movement, we've seen all the space stuff. And Caleb was wandering in the wilderness that same amount of time, Lord Christ. But he told Joshua, "The Lord has kept me alive these 45 years, even since the Lord spake this word unto Moses, while the children of Israel wandered in the wilderness. And now, lo, I am this day 85 years old." Caleb was 85 years old. So he was 40 when he went to the promised land. 45 years had passed since Caleb laid eyes on that mountain. But he said, "And yet I am as strong this day as I was in the day that Moses sent me. As my strength was then, so my strength is now."